Joining us now, Republican Congressman Adam Kinzinger of Illinois. Congressman, thanks very much for coming in.
Thanks.
You've adamantly refused, at least so far, to endorse, to support, to say you're going to vote for Donald Trump. Did Governor Pence's performance last night impact you at all to maybe change your mind?
No, not yet, but he did a great job. It was an amazing debate to hear two people really kind of maturely, to an extent, talk about issues that are really important. I thought an amazing thing that came out of that was you had bipartisan agreement that we have to do more in Syria than what's been done, that Aleppo's a tragedy, that we have an ability to do some things. And so I thought Governor Pence performed really well. And if I'm Donald Trump, I'm taking lessons now from how Pence performed and the rave reviews he got, and I'm going to try to model my town hall appearance after
that. If Pence were at the top of the ticket, would you vote for that?
Oh, yeah, in a heartbeat, in
really?
A second. I think Pence is a fan. I served them for a couple years in the House. Fantastic guy. He's got his head in the right spot. And, you know, if he should ever be called upon to be president, I think he'd do a fantastic job.
All right, speaking of Syria, you raised the issue. I want to play a clip. This is Mike Pence last night at the debate saying the U.S. should be prepared to use military force against the Syrian government if Russia doesn't stop supporting Assad's regime. Listen to this.
Provocations by Russia need to be met with American strength. And if Russia chooses to be involved and continue, I should say, to be involved in this barbaric attack on civilians in Aleppo, the United States of America should be prepared to use military force to strike military targets of the Assad regime, to prevent them from this humanitarian crisis that is taking place in Aleppo.
I see. You just heard him suggest that maybe the U.S. should use military force against Russia, even in Syria. Do you agree with him?
Well, I think it's essential that we enact a cost on the regime for violating the ceasefire. I think we have to have an or else out there in order to negotiate the next ceasefire, which is or else we will continue to strike more targets. I think it's essential. And I think the thing people fail to realize in this debate is this isn't just about humanitarianism in Syria. That's tragic and a huge issue and compelling in and of itself. But this is about the mass migration of people out of the Middle East into Europe, where now you have a rise of these nationalistic parties. You had Brexit. This is affecting the whole geopolitical sphere. And I remember back in the Red Line debate, you know, people told me if we attack Syria, it's just going to make the problem worse. We didn't attack Syria, and it has gotten way worse beyond our wildest nightmares.
But you listened to Donald Trump over all of these months, and you listened to Pence last night. These two guys seemed, at least on this specific issue of Syria, to be on different tracks.
I noticed that, too. And I hope that Donald Trump takes from Pence's performance last night and what he said, whether it's pushing back on Russia, whether it's, you know, striking Assad, and mirrors that and means it on Sunday. If he doesn't, then that's very concerning to me. But I thought what Pence said yesterday was emblematic of where America needs to be. And frankly, Kane agreed. There was bipartisan agreement.
But this could start a larger war with Russia. Are you ready for that?
Well, I think the Russians, if they know we're serious, they're not interested in starting a war with us. They have an economy size of Italy. They have a military far inferior to ours, but they are able to push right now up to where they hit a stop, and they haven't hit any stops yet. I think you have to give them fair warning. Look, there will be a no-fly zone. Look, we are going to strike regime targets, and if they happen to get into the middle of that, that's a decision they make. It's not a decision we're making.
Pence also said the U.S. should be prepared to help, to work with others to establish what he called the safe zones in Syria, where refugees, humanitarian assistance could be provided. Potentially, that could be pretty dangerous too.
It could be. And you have the Turks right now, in essence, on the border of Syria doing this by de facto. When the Turkish military moved into Syria, you have a little bit of safe zones being established now. But that will take probably American air power and Western air power. But look, there are friends all over the region that are begging for us to do something and alleviate the crisis, and they're going to be willing to do a lot of the military action too. Nobody, I've never heard anybody in 5 years advocate for 100,000 American military in Syria. But the inaction, the cost of inaction is beyond what we can imagine, and further inaction is only going to get worse.
There's considerable difference in the words that Pence uses as far as Putin is concerned, the words that Trump calls him a strong leader. Pence last night called him a small and bullying leader. I assume you agree with Pence.
I do agree with Pence.
And so how do you explain the fact that the presidential nominee on the Republican ticket, the vice presidential nominee on the Republican ticket, they express these different views?
Yeah, I don't know. And this is what I think Donald Trump's going to have to explain it. We're going to see what he says on Sunday. I'm sure he's going to be asked about this. This is why I've been reticent to support the ticket, is because of the concern with Russia and the concern with what's going on in Syria and foreign policy. We don't want more people to get nukes and everything else. So I think it's, again, all eyes are going to be on the debate on Sunday. Donald Trump has an opportunity to mirror Pence's language and I think win a lot of support and gain back in the polls. If he doesn't, I fear it's going to continue as it is.
Congressman, you're a military veteran. You've been in Iraq and Afghanistan. We're following some breaking news coming in, new details on another alleged case of a high-ranking U.S. military contractor stealing, allegedly, secrets from the National Security Agency here in Washington. We'll update our viewers on that. Reporting, we're back with Republican Congressman Adam Kinzinger of Illinois. You know a lot about classified information, the NSA. You serve, still serve in the U.S. Air Force. You served in Iraq and Afghanistan. The NSA, which is the pinnacle of U.S. intelligence capabilities, electronic intelligence, once again, apparently something like this could happen. How do you explain that?
Well, I can't explain it, and it angers me. I think, you know, after the Snowden stuff, and by the way, when it's all found out what Snowden has stolen, which I know a lot of it, and it's not all declassified yet, it was a lot, and it was extremely damaging. These people that have this idea, whether they're working for a foreign government or whether they're on some man crusade that somehow they're going to determine American foreign policy by going onto a computer and downloading something and releasing it to some crazies on the internet is wrong and bad. And that needs to stop. And whatever it takes for the contractor or for the U.S. government to ensure this doesn't happen needs to happen, because we cannot continue in perpetuity creating things that are necessary for statecraft, which is very important for what we do for protecting Americans, leaked on the internet.
You think there are more Snowdens out there serving in the U.S. government?
I didn't think so until today when we find out this arrest. There easily could be. And I think we have to, and I don't know the process for it, I'm not going to pretend to, a top-down and a bottom-up look at people's clearances, what access they have, and making sure that the wrong people don't have access to the wrong stuff.
I want to play a clip, a controversial clip. Donald Trump said this the other day about U.S. military personnel who come back from Iraq and Afghanistan and have real serious post-traumatic stress problems. Listen to this.
When you talk about the mental health problems, when people come back from war and combat and they see things that maybe a lot of the folks in this room have seen many times over, and you're strong and you can handle it, but a lot of people can't handle it.
A lot of people can't handle it. What was your reaction when you heard that?
My initial reaction wasn't good. And, you know, obviously I thought that that was a very inartful way to say it. But then when I thought about it, you know, I've been critical of Donald Trump. We know that. I think that was something that I don't necessarily put on him as meaning that he thinks there are weak veterans out there. So I'm not going to hit him as hard as maybe some people would on that. I think he should clarify it, come back and say that he didn't mean that. But I'm not going to hit him as hard as probably some out there would.
I know you're going to be going on active duty very soon.
Yeah.
I wish you the best of luck.
Thanks
very much, Congressman Adam Kinzinger of Illinois. Coming up.